Hi students, welcome back. Now let's go through the remaining portions of this chapter. This was also a period of great mobility. Groups of people traveled long distances in search of opportunity. The subcontinent held immense wealth and the possibilities for people to carve a fortune. So this period was of great mobility. That means people has traveled in search of several opportunities. And they have landed on different places of the subcontinent. One group of people who became important in this period were the Rajputs, a name derived from Rajputra, the son of a ruler. Between the 8th and 14th centuries, the term was applied more generally to a group of warriors who claimed Kshatriya caste status. The term included not just rulers and chieftains, but also soldiers and commanders who served in the armies of different monarchs all over the subcontinent. So one such group who has traveled was the Rajputs. This name came from Rajputra, which means the son of a ruler. And by 8th and 14th century, this term has been used to a group of people who are from the Kshatriya caste. And this term was used for a group of people which include rulers, chieftains, soldiers, commanders, etc. A chivalric code of conduct, extreme valor, and a great sense of loyalty were the qualities attributed to Rajputs by their poets and bards. Other groups of people, such as the Marathas, Sikhs, Jats, Ahoms, and Kayasthas, also used the opportunities of the age to become politically important. So this period was used by all these groups of Marathas, Sikhs, Jats, Ahoms, and Kayasthas to become politically important. Throughout this period, there was a gradual clearing of forest and the extension of agriculture, a change faster and more complete in some areas than in others. So during this period, there was also clearing of the forest and agricultural activities has been taken place. Changes in their habitat forced many forest dwellers to migrate. Since these forest areas was been cleared, these forest dwellers, their natural habitat has been changed, and therefore these forest dwellers had migrated. Others started tilling the land and become peasants. These new peasants group gradually began to influenced by regional markets, chieftains, priests, monasteries, and temples. So some people, such as the forest dwellers, has migrated as their natural habitat has been changed. But certain people, such as the peasants, has started to tilling the land, and therefore they were gradually influenced by the regional markets, chieftains, priests, monasteries, and temples. They become part of large complex societies, and they require to pay taxes and to offer goods and services to local lords. So as these people have started their agricultural activities, they have to pay taxes and also give services to their local lords. As a result, significant economic and social differences emerged among peasants. Some possessed more productive land, other also kept cattle, and some combined artisanal work with agricultural activity during the lean season. So several economic and social differences has been emerged among these persons. Some has kept some productive lands, others kept some cattle and all. Okay, so some had done both artists and agricultural activities together. As society became more differentiated, people were grouped into jatis or subcastes and ranked on the basis of their backgrounds and their occupations. Ranks were not fixed permanently and varied according to the power, influence, and resources controlled by members of the jati. The status of the same jati could vary from area to area. So as the society has been grown up, the people has been differentiated on the basis of jatis, subcastes, and ranked on the backgrounds of their occupation they had carried out. and these ranks were not permanent, as the power, influence and resources has been changed, the jatis has also been changed. Jatis framed their own rules and regulations to manage the conduct of their members. These regulations were enforced by an assembly of elders, described in some areas as the jati panchayat, but jatis were also required to follow the rules of their villages. Several villages were governed by a chieftain. Together they were only one small unit of a state. So each jatis has framed their own rules and regulations, and all the members in that jati have to follow these rules and regulations. And these rules and regulations has been described in jati panchayat also. So each jatis have to follow the rules of their own villages also, and these villages were governed by chieftains. Region on empire. Large states like those of Cholas, Tughlaqs or Mughals encompassed many regions. So these Cholas, Tughlaqs and Mughals has encompassed many regions. A Sanskrit prashasti praising the Delhi Sultan Ghiyasuddin Balban explained that he was the ruler of a vast empire that stretched from Bengal in the east to Ghazni in Afghanistan in the west and included all of the South India. So Delhi Sultan Ghiyasuddin Balban, he has ruled a vast empire which has been stretched from Bengal to Afghanistan, and even it included so many places of the South Indias also. So it was such a vast empire. People of different regions, Gowda, Andhra, Kerala, Karnataka, Maharashtra and Gujarat, apparently fled before his armies. Historians regard these as exaggerated claims of conquest. At the same time, they try to understand why rulers kept claiming to have control over different parts of the subcontinent. So people from different regions such as Gowda, Andhra, Kerala, Karnataka, Maharashtra and Gujarat was a part of this Delhi Sultan Ghiyasuddin Balban. And historians has also understood that why these rulers has extended their control over different parts of the subcontinent. By 700, many regions already possessed distinct geographical dimensions and their own language and cultural characteristics. You will learn more about these in chapter 9. They were also associated with specific ruling dynasties. There was considerable conflict between these states. Occasionally, dynasties like the Cholas, Khaljis, Tughlaqs and Mughals were able to build an empire that was pan-regional, spanning diverse regions. Not all these empires were equally stable or successful. Compare, for example, Table 1 in Chapter 3 and 4. What was the duration of rule of the Khalji and Mughal dynasties? So by 700, many regions had its own geographical dimensions, their own languages and as well as cultural characteristics. So these Cholas, Khaljis, Tughlaqs and Mughals has built up their own empire. But all of these empires were not successful. When the Mughal Empire declined in 18th century, it led to the re-emergence of regional states. But years of imperial pan-regional rule had altered the character of the regions. Across most of the subcontinents, the regions were left with the legacies of the big and small states that had ruled over them. This was apparent in the emergence of many distinct and shared traditions. In the realms of governance, the management of the economy, allied cultures and language. Through the 1000 years between 700 and 1750, the characters of the different regions did not grow in isolation. These regions felt the impact of larger pan-regional forces of integration without ever quite losing their distinctiveness. So as this Mughal Empire has been declared in the 18th century, several other regional states has been emerged. So as one empire has been declined, several other big and small states has been developed and they started to rule over the people. But all these empires were not at all successful. Many has been declined within a short period of time. So between this 700 and 1750 period, different regions has been developed and they had started to grow in isolation. So students, we will discuss the remaining portion of the chapter in next video. All of you subscribe to the channel and press the bell icon so that you will get the notification of next video. See you soon. Thank you.